Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this third webinar in the series of the four webinars that we are planning to conduct on Parkinson's disease education for patients and caregivers. Every year around World Parkinson's Day, we come up with different kinds of activities under the Parkinson Care Trust, which is a Parkinson's Trust to help look after the patients and support patient-related activities of Parkinson's disease, and jointly joined hands by Jaslok Hospital and Research Center in Mumbai. I'm Dr. Paresh Doshi. These are some of the glimpses that we do about the activities that we do during the World Parkinson's Day celebrations. As we all know, World Parkinson Day is celebrated in the memory of Dr. James Parkinson, who initially gave us the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. One of the activities that we engage in every year on year is a free patient diagnosis camp. And this is a very organized camp. It is not like a public camp where anyone can walk in. Appointments are given by proper registration and prior screening. And all the patients are seen by a consultant, initially screened by the resident doctors or junior staff, and then seen by senior consultant. So these are the pictures of patient diagnosis camp. In the good old times when we could meet each other freely and engage into social gatherings and interaction with people face to face, we would have such kinds of patient education seminar, the one which today we are doing as a web-based. But I think everything has a silver lining. And the best thing about this webinar is that we have people joining us from all parts of India and many other parts of the world. And that is the beauty of this, having a web-based webinar versus what we would have done physically, which many of you would not have been able to attend. So here we can see patients sharing their experiences, myself giving a lecture, and other people talking about various aspects of Parkinson's disease. The Parkinson Care Trust also assists in offering financial assistance, mainly to the patients undergoing surgery, because these are the areas where they do not find any funding or support. And especially for patients who have suffered from Parkinson's disease and already undergone DBS, and if they cannot find funds for a replacement battery, the trust helps them in financial assistance. We plan to increase the activities of the Parkinson Care Trust through the networks of the patient and initiated by the patient and recommended by the patient. We would be providing regular, because the research in Parkinson's disease is moving very fast. And correct research information is essential to be well informed. So we plan to update you through this, either webinars or blogs, and help the caregivers understand the disease better and manage the disease better. So I would invite you to join this. You can take a picture of this on your camera, via mobile phone, and later on join the Parkinson Care Trust using this small web link and to get more updates, or even to get access to the recorded webinar of the past two and the 2 days. These are the glimpses of the first webinar wherein we talked about how to improve quality of life of Parkinson's disease and many aspects of diet and other things that are related to Parkinson's disease. This was the second webinar where we talked about yoga, meditation, exercise, and the most important was the speech therapy that helped how to improve the quality of life of patients of Parkinson's disease, and specifically exercises for Parkinson's disease, which would help them improve their balance and posture. Today is our third webinar, and today we are going to focus on some motivational experience, and that is why the title of the webinar is Conquering Parkinson's Disease, and we would be having motivational speeches from a few Parkinson's disease patients who have actually conquered the Parkinson's disease. And rather than me telling about that to you, let us hear it directly from the patients. We have Dr. Shanti Priya, Mr. Godbole, Mr. Hari Prasad, and Dr. Kakkar. So there are two doctors who have been able to make themselves or rise above the Parkinson's disease, and there are two other gentlemen who have exemplary role they have played in society, who would highlight as to how they have been able to manage the disease. And I'm sure that this inspiring discussion will assist all of us to be more inspired and to learn from that. Ms. Bharti Karkera, she is the Parkinson's disease nurse specialist. She has been working tirelessly with Parkinson's disease patients for more than last 20 years. And she is going to talk from her own experience and guide as to the how the caretakers can improve their quality of life. Because so far we all have been focusing on the patient, but we also need to understand that there is something what is called caretaker fatigue or caretaker burden that has to be addressed, because unless the caretaker is doing well, the patient will also not do well. So we have decided that this webinar will focus on that. And then we have a very eminent speaker, Dr. Rebecca Gilbert. I will introduce you her to you before her talk, and finally some question answers that we can discuss. You are free to type your questions in the chat box and we will take them at the end of the seminar. With that, the last webinar is going to be on the medical and surgical management and update on Parkinson's disease. One of the unique things that is going to be talked about apart from the medical and surgical updates is going to be do's and don'ts after DBS. So patients who have undergone DBS have many questions as what they can do and what they cannot do. We will be focusing this on the latest that we know about this, and that will be discussed in the last webinar. With that, I think I will end sharing my screen and will ask Mrs. Bharti Karkera to share her screen and start her presentation.
First slide, please. Sir, I should have first slide. Yes. Hello, good evening, everyone. I'm Ms. Bharti Karkera. So today I'm going to share some tips for caregivers, those who are loved ones suffering from Parkinson's disease. So at most, the first visit to the doctor and it's been diagnosed that your loved one is suffering from Parkinson's disease, so it becomes a shock, anger. It's human. So having us emotional feelings, it's natural, because if you feel that you're disbelief, anger, denial, so it is not easy to accept that. So it is very difficult to be a caregiver for your loved ones. So I'm just going to share some tips for your caregivers. Next, please. Acceptance. It is what it is. Accept it and move on. So accept to the diagnosis means the time comes to the diagnosis of your Parkinson's disease and understanding of your progression of disease. It is adapt to the diagnosis. It is not an easy task to understand the progression of disease. So it changes over it, and your role also changes it. So understand, next is understand how your loved ones feel. It is very difficult to accept that your reality of your illness, because at that time you have emotional feelings like they have a fear of the future, and they don't know how to do the adjustment or how to go about it. So one should understand their feelings of Parkinson's disease. And so about plans and expectation should be flexible, because the Parkinson's disease is such an unpredictable disease that at once your loved ones will be very independent, and they can manage to do all their activities by themselves. But at the same time, they will be very much dependent on you for their day-to-day activities. So your plans and adjustment and expectation should be flexibly to manage with your loved ones. Second is focus on what they can. It's better to understand what your loved one is doing it in day-to-day activities, which rather than they can't do it. So if you focus it, they will encourage by themselves. They will try to do the daily living task. So that is the way they can improve their quality of life. Next, please. The key is the most important to keep educating yourself. Stay informed. Means you have to understand, you have to educate yourself to enough awareness and knowledge how to coping with your loved ones who is suffering from Parkinson's disease. So understanding means their progression of disease, their disability, their medicine schedule, their proper taking care with exercise and all. You have to be understood what their requirement, what is going on with your loved ones. Be organized. In that, your loved ones, you're the one who is going to take care of everything, having appointments or follow up with your treating doctor and required to organize all your medical records in order so that easily when you visit your doctor, you can have it handy. And then you have to have a financial arrangement for an emergency, to have a hospitalization in case in an emergency. Plus, you have to have the medicine schedule on time so you can have a reminder call on your mobile so you'll be able to give them on-time medication which is required for your loved one. Then you should have a proper contact number of your treating doctor or hospital number in handy. So in emergency, you can easily contact your doctors or requirement for the hospitalization. So that is the way you should well organize. So it goes very smoothly and comfortable for yourself and your loved ones. Offer love and support. It is very necessary to give them love and support in their challenging in Parkinson's disease. Next, please. Communicating with them. So loved ones always who is suffering from Parkinson's, they always feel isolated. They have been depressed, mood swings. So they want someone to share their feeling. So encourage your loved ones to have a talk with them. Let them open out with their feelings and they should know that there is someone to listen to you. So there will be expectation changes in relationship, because with mood swings and depression, it's a part of Parkinson's disease. So whatever changes you see, it is not easy to handle such changes what you notice in with your loved ones. So you have a difficulties to adjust with that. You should have some time, both of you, to have a new role in relationship. So ask your loved one to speak slow and loud so that opposite person can understand what they're trying to speak, because they have a difficulty in speaking. So you train them in a such a way that they can put it in a day-to-day activities to practice in a such a way. Next, please. Help them feel normal. Because the disease like Parkinson, they can interfere with a normal life, anyone. So be open, involve your loved ones to have to act in daily activities. Don't talk about their disease or their disability. So you can divert their mind, involve them with their interested hobbies or their favorite stories or movies or a book. So you should involve them so that particular moments they should feel that they enjoy that feelings of normal feelings as a person. Next, please. Look for worsening symptoms. The caregiver, the spouse, should be observant. You're the close one to your loved ones to noticeable whatever changes, the severity of symptoms, their disability, their coordination, they're facing problem with the difficulty in walking, speaking, imbalance, and mood swings. Whatever you see these changes, it is you have to keep these updates to your treating doctor so that they have a adjustment of the medicine to help them to come out with these difficulties. So, however, the without treatment, the depression can lead faster physical decline. Next, please. Do not put your life on hold, especially this is for caregivers. I mean to say there are caregivers, maybe spouse or husband or wife or children. The spouse will be elderly, 60 plus. For them, it is very difficult to adjust with daily activities, with their own lives, like handling with household work, cleaning, cooking, as well as additional to look after your loved ones. It's very hectic and tiresome for the caregiver. So they forget about themselves. Why they should do that? They think about themselves. If you're physically, emotionally fit to take care of your old loved one, so you have to have some time for yourself. Make sure that you get enough time for relaxation, for rest or meditation, so you get some relief of de-stress. Meet some friends, go out for shopping, eat some balanced diet, and exercise regularly so that you can look after your loved ones. Share the care. Let me tell you, Parkinson patient is not alone. They're always surrounded by their family members. And for the care plan for the Parkinson patient is always the family members has to involve in plan. So only one person cannot just cope up with the day-to-day's activities and managing your loved ones. So please, that loved one should seek for some help. Talk to, discuss with your family members, enlist your help, have some break so you have that, you don't feel like that you have a burden to look after your loved ones. So each family member should help them to take and involve them in take care of plan of your loved ones to providing care in day-to-day activities. And that is the way you can improve your quality of life of your loved ones. So otherwise also you can hire someone to assist you in providing care when you have difficulties, no one is there, you're elderly, so you have some extra help to look after your loved ones. Next, please. The checklist for the caregiver for daily care for their loved ones. These all activities which are mentioned here, grooming, bathing, dressing, getting dressed up, eating, activities, these all things should be done on phase period. On phase period means when you take medicine and you get good on with it. So you try to manage by yourself day-to-day's activity since from morning. For example, when you go to the washroom, you should be able to have a sitting arrangement for brushing your teeth, electrical toothbrush available, you can make use of it, electrical shaver is there. So it is very easy to help for your day-to-day's activities. Even bathing, that bathing, you should have a shower preferably and sitting arrangement under the shower with a safety bar holding that support, so that they can finish their task comfortably. Getting dressed up. Make sure that your loved one should have a light, comfortable put-on dress with band with some elastic band and shorts, if the buttons are there, replaced with your Velcro, so easily they can manage by themselves comfortably. Eating is another difficulties for Parkinson's patients. So loved one has chewing, swallowing issues. So the caregiver should make sure that they should prepare some moist and solid and soft food for their loved ones so they can easily swallow. And they have difficulties to finish their meals in time. So involve them, your loved one, in activities. Don't try to do it by yourself. So with this, you can give them the extra time, for example, getting dressed up or eating. So they should be able to complete their task, taking some extra more time. Activities like when they're on good on, you can plan for some outdoor activities, going for a walk with your loved ones, or going for a jogging, or you can plan for the dinner outside, because you will have some change in day-to-day activities. Once you are out, you feel some change, so you can enjoy that some moment of that period. Next, please. So caring for your loved ones is a major responsibility, but you have the ability to enhance quality of life with Parkinson's, because the loved ones have the more expectation from the caregiver, but caregiver has to have good quality of life to improve your loved ones. Thank you very much. I hope that I have tried to cover up all necessary tips for your loved ones, and it will be beneficial for you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thanks, Mrs. Bharti. It was a very nice presentation. What few things can stop sharing the screen? Huh? So the few important aspects that I would like for people to take home are that interpersonal relationship between a patient of Parkinson's disease and caregiver is highly important. And as the disease is going to be a long haul battle, it's not going to be a short disease like any cancer or any short term illness. It is a disease of disability which is going to be for a long haul. It is important that both the parties are properly educated, and both the parties should give each other some space. And this is something that in our Indian concept, we have not been aligned to. And this is very important. We have to understand both human beings are different, and both human beings should be given a little space. That even the patient needs a space, and the caregiver needs his or her space. So that is very important. And this understanding will help you go a long way in fighting the disease. Another thing I want people listening to this webinar also to do is that I want this to be interactive. If you have any suggestions or anything that you think we are not covering, or you would like that to be covered in the future webinar, you can put it down in the question and answer area, and we will try to address that in the next webinar. For example, in the last webinar, we had people who had sent us messages after the webinar saying that we needed more on meditation and yoga. Probably after 2 months, we will be coming out with an exclusive session on yoga therapy only for Parkinson's disease patient. So this is not going to be a yoga, like a yoga treatment, but it will be a yoga therapy for only focused on Parkinson's disease patients, and that who can, what they can do and what they cannot do. So this is what we are going to do. We are going on to move on to the next part of the talks. And this is the most interesting part for me as well, because this is an inspiring talk from each of the people of Parkinson's disease. I would not say patients, I would say people suffering from Parkinson's disease who have conquered or mastered the art of living with it and getting better off it. So we start with Dr. Shanti Priya, and I invite Dr. Shanti Priya to share her experience about her journey through Parkinson's disease.
Yeah, good evening, everybody. I first like to thank Jaslok Hospital Dr. Paresh Doshi and Mrs. Bharati for giving me this opportunity. Can my slide be shared, please? Yeah, I'm Dr. Shanti Priya, a consultant ophthalmologist by profession, a writer, a self-taught artist, founder of SAR Foundation to make a difference in the life of a person with Parkinson's, and a young onset Parkinson's disease warrior since 10 years. Next, please. Next slide, yeah. I've had a bumpy journey so far with a lot of ups and downs. The trick is to enjoy the ups and have the courage to face the downs. Next slide. Early 2011, loss of swing movement of my right upper arm was noticed by my son and husband. I first ignored it, and after a few months, I was not able to wear my slippers on the right side. That was when I went to a neurologist who gave me the diagnosis of young onset Parkinson's disease. I first could not accept it, and I kept asking me the question, why me? Because I had no family history at all. Then I went to another neurologist and another, and they all gave me the same diagnosis. Next, please. That was when I started reading about Parkinson's in detail and reading about people with young onset Parkinson's, like the American actor Michael J. Fox, boxer Muhammad Ali, and the cyclist Davis Finney. Their stories inspired me a lot, and I slowly started accepting the disease. Next, please. I read that exercise delays the disease progression. I started doing high intensity interval training, spinning, Zumba, weight training, and studies show that exercising greater than 150 minutes a week definitely delays the progression of the disease. Next, please. 2018 was a turning point in my life when I stumbled upon the opportunity to take part in a Mrs. International's pageant held in Singapore for married women. It was difficult as it was not my comfort zone. I had to time the medications according to the rounds, wear heels, and compete with normal people. But I did it just to show that Parkinson's can never define me. And I won the title of Most Empowered Woman 2018 and 19. It was during the making of the video that I revealed to the whole world that I have Parkinson's. Next slide, please. And when I came back, I started first my Instagram handle, Shake Off and Move On, and my Facebook page of the same name. Next slide. And my support group in early April 2019, I started my foundation, SAR Foundation, based upon the acronym Support, Awareness, Action, and Rehabilitate People with Parkinson's to Lead a Better Quality of Life through Active Lifestyle. We conduct workshops to live well with Parkinson's, like yoga, tai chi, sound healing, exercises, speech therapy. We have programs for caregivers too. And I conduct a lot of awareness programs to remove the social stigma attached to this. And my main objective is to start a neuro rehab center to benefit people with neurological conditions. Next slide, please. And I won many awards. One was South Indian Woman Achievers Award, Saraswati Dada Saheb Phalke Award, Radiant Wellness Award for Excellence in Medical Field. Next slide. The second turning point in my life was on 30th November 2019, when I had my deep brain stimulation. Before the DBS, I used to suffer from dystonia every single day. And I used to take medicines every 2 hours. and it never seemed to work well. Lot of motor fluctuations between on and off periods. But after the deep brain stimulation, I've not had a single day of dystonia, and it has definitely improved my quality of life. Next slide. And in June 2019, I attended the World Parkinson's Coalition at Kyoto, which is a conference for people with Parkinson's, caregivers, neurologists, neurosurgeons, scientists, researchers, all under one roof. And I was able to meet a lot of young onset people, young onset Parkinson's people who are global patient advocates. And I, through this, I got the opportunity to be a global patient advocate by being the ambassador for World Parkinson's Coalition 2020-22. And it's going to be held in Barcelona next year. Next slide, please. Next slide. I recently held my art exhibition at a gallery in Chennai. And I released my first book, Metamorphosis, Reflections on My Life's Journey. It's a book of art and poetry. Another talent which I discovered during the COVID times, that I could write poetry. It has 36 art pieces and poetry written by me. Next slide, please. And I've done a guest role in a web series which is going to be released soon. I'm telling you all this that Parkinson's care has never defined my life. Before Parkinson's, I was only a consultant ophthalmologist. But after Parkinson's, I've become a writer. I've become a model. I've become an actor, an artist. And Parkinson's has never defined me and stopped me from doing what I want. And that is because of I had a full support of friends and family. Next slide, please. And you can definitely live well with Parkinson's. And we all together can fight back Parkinson's. Next slide. So follow your heart, follow your passion. We have only one life to live. Live it to the fullest. And last but not the least, never give up. Shake off and move on. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shantipriya. That was an excellent talk. Very inspiring, and several hats that you have worn, and a real thing that you came out of your cocoon, and actually the Parkinson disease actually made you come out of and bring out the best out of you. And I think that is what was the purpose of this, having you talk on this forum, and we are happy that it has gone this direction, and we wish you all the luck and all the success in your many endeavors. And we also appreciate your work towards helping Parkinson's disease patients through creating awareness and your social services. The next patient we have is Mr. Sandesh Godbole. And let us hear the story from him. Mr. Godbole.
Yeah. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, we can hear you. Yeah.
Sir, can you
please?
Yeah. Can you audio visual to you? Can you please play that audio visual?
Yeah, we'll change. Yeah. Hello?
Yeah.
I think what has happened? Let me just check. I think they are changing. Mr. Thakkar, want to share his slides? Mr. Sandesh Godbole.
Thank you.
everybody. My name is Sandesh Kulbole. I am 50 years old and suffering from Parkinson's disease for last 16 years. In the year 2017, I underwent DBA surgery, and after the surgery, my life was totally changed. In the year 2018, I won one global award for innovation in my textile field. I became more independent, I can do my regular activities, I can work in my office more efficiently. After the surgery, I have traveled abroad to attend the conferences. I also pursue my hobbies. I play tabla, though dealing with the disease, I am enjoying my life. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Kulbole, you would like to say a few words on from your side?
Yeah, give me a surgery totally changed my life actually. Earlier my case was hopeless actually. But after DBS, it totally changed. I have the more independent.
Sure.
Yeah.
Good. Mm-hmm. Encouraging. Okay, so now we next move on to another very illustrious speaker, again a multifaceted personality, Mr. Hari Prasad. And rather than me telling you about him, let us hear about himself from his own journey of life through the Parkinson's disease. Mr. Hari Prasad, please.
Hello. At the outset, I'd like to thank Jaspur Seslok Hospital, Dr. Paresh Doshi and Bharti Madam for giving me this opportunity to speak to all of you. And I also would like to thank my co-panelists, Dr. Shanti Priya, Dr. Anil Kakkar and Mr. Sandesh Godbole for being such a great inspiration for me. Thank you very much, sirs. while you've seen the title, it says change attitude, find a cure. And that's exactly what Mr. Godbole has done. He's changed his attitude and has found a cure. And Dr. Shantipriya also has done the same thing. Well, the next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah. And a decent middle class upbringing. My background is just that. Went to IIT, India's premier technological institute. Joined Tata Motors in Pune. Left them to do my MBA at XLRI Jamshedpur. Worked in Toltas. Next 11 years. Worked Sultanate of Oman for 7 years. Returned to India for an American embassy in North India. That's when tragedy struck. Next slide, please. In early 2008, diagnosed to have Parkinson's disease. Was managing with dopamine agonist till 2012. Moved on to Singapore Plus, the gold standard in gold dopa drugs. End of 2014, my symptoms had worsened. Dystonia and dyskinesia were very, very severe. In March 2015, my DBS was performed. Took voluntary retirement from my job in 2015. I was only 55 years of age. Since then, I've led an all my life. Time now for my first passion, traveling. I've extensively traveled around India and the globe since my DBS. North, West, East and Central India, Bhutan and Nepal. For 340 plus days road trips, I've done 340 plus road trips. Turkey, New Zealand, Australia were 3 road trips respectively. Egypt, Germany, Czech Republic, Slovakia, Hungary, Austria, the UK, the USA. In all the countries that I've visited in the last 6 years now. Next slide. Traveling gives me a sense of accomplishment. Conduct awareness programs and breast briefs along the way. That's one thing we do, is that we don't just let it be just a travel. We do some awareness programs for Parkinson's disease and breast briefs along the way. And meet a lot of people from different walks of life. Talk to them about PD, DBS. Eat and drink various exotic stuff along the way. See different places in the process. Yes, please. We conduct seminars, press briefs, and patient meets along the way. We've done it in Ranchi, Calcutta, we've done it in Nagpur, we've done it in Ahmedabad, we've done it in Pune, we've done it in Kathmandu in Nepal, 3 of them, in fact, Kathmandu in Nepal. We've done it in so many other places. We've done it in Varanasi, we've done it in Lucknow, and all these places. Next slide. Well covered by the media. You notice that I've got articles there from Times of India, Express News Service, and a Kannada paper. Next slide. What do you do once you come back from a road trip? Administer a WhatsApp group of around 35 persons. They are patients, caregivers, medical professionals in the group. And that's where I've met Mr. Dr. Shantipriya and Dr. Anil Kakkar also. They're also part of my WhatsApp group. And Dr. Paresh Doshi and Bharati Madam both are part of my WhatsApp group. Conduct yoga and physiotherapy sessions, general counseling sessions, doctor visits for new patients, pre-DBS visits, post-DBS visits. And more than important, we also give motivation lectures to PD groups across the country. We've done it in the UK and we've done it in Nepal too. Invited by Medtronic India to address the 1,000 plus staff at their annual meet. How do I keep myself active nowadays? I'm mentally active by doing Sudoku puzzles and playing online bridge daily. Swim and cycle whenever able. Walk regularly and climb stairs. Exercise, eat, sleep, and sleep well. Eat well and sleep well. Sense of accomplishment is what, at the end of the day, that is what I try to achieve. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hariprasad. Once again, a very inspirational talk and inspirational journey of a long-standing battle against Parkinson's disease and how you have mastered and conquered it. Your activities keep you busy. The activities give you a purpose of life, and the activities has been the driving force behind you. And once again, patients of Parkinson's disease will be thankful for all your hard work in keeping them updated and connected through WhatsApp group. which I think is very active all the time.
Thank you, doctor.
The last is the inspirational talk by Dr. Anil Kakkar. Now, we had coincidentally three people who have undergone deep brain stimulation surgery on this webinar to talk about their journey. All three people have excelled in their activities of their all the activities of their sphere and outside the sphere of their activities. They have some or little or more minor disabilities, but that they have never considered to be a impeding factor in their quality of life or journey. We have Dr. Kakkar, who has not undergone DBS. So I didn't want a message to go through this platform that DBS is the only way to conquer Parkinson's disease. We can battle the Parkinson's disease without DBS, and Dr. Kakkar will explain how many years he has been suffering and how he has mastered the art of living and avoiding DBS. And to top it up, I've just been told that he has just been out of the hospital a few days back after an illness. So this, his particular presence here in our forum only goes on to inspire all of us. Dr. Kakkar, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and my special thanks to you, Dr. Joshi and Bharti madam. And hello. Yeah, Bharti madam. And special thanks to the organizers of the from Jaslok Hospital and Parkinson Care Trust. It's been a great honor and a privilege for me. And I am really very happy to be here. Before I start, I'll just like, with all due respect and my highest regards to Dr. Doshi, you mentioned that these four patients are suffering from Parkinson. I'm not suffering from Parkinson. I'm not a victim. I'm in a constant battle with Parkinson. Sorry.
Well, absolutely. That is the spirit. And that comes from your background of being an armed force personnel.
Yeah, I'm in a constant battle with the Parkinson for the last 17 years. Anyhow, next slide, please. How much good or talented you are, there are sometimes when things are not going to be all right. And what may happen will happen. The disaster will strike you. That is a time when you or most of us are emotionally or physically broken. And it will leave a mark on you, whether it is a victory or a defeat. What is important, that time you will be hearing two sets of voices. One will be saying wisdom, faith, and gratitude. Other side will be worry, blame, and grumbling. It is that time you require somebody to inspire you, motivate you, because that will be added as a fuel to the your life, power of the life. And because otherwise, the small things look like a big mountain. The problems are not so big. It is the problems are small, you don't know how to handle them. So that is the time you require someone to inspire you and decide. And then ultimately, it is the end matters whether you are you use that thing as a winner. You get more stronger and more knowledgeable than we were before. Next slide, please. Well, like any other person, when I was also diagnosed about 17 years back, I had all these questions. Why me? Why life is so unfair? And we all know these things have got no meaning. Because nobody will get an answer to this. And ultimately, you have to realize that it is Almighty's plans and there is no negotiation there, unfortunately. Next slide. Well, I'll not go into the details how I was diagnosed Parkinson, because I am being a doctor and my wife being an oncopathologist. Somehow I did the self-diagnosis. And then when we consulted the neurologist, and all initially they kept telling me, you having anxiety tremors. I said, no, there is no anxiety. But they were not believing. You say you are young, 48, 49 year old. How can you be having this problem? Anyhow, that's a long story which can be spoken later on. When I was diagnosed with Parkinson, I accepted it as a part of reality. because I never allowed the negativity to come to my mind. Somebody said, you are suffering. I said, no, I'm not suffering. So I kept a very positive attitude in the life. And I continued to do my professional work as I was doing before and maintain a very congenial atmosphere in the house. Never let the children or to come to know the close relatives whether I'm suffering from this problem or not. Next slide, please. Well, we all know Parkinson is not lifestyle disease. And I know I had done nothing wrong, because in lifestyle diseases, there are certain precautions or something you have not done. It is just a chance. So I quickly came in terms with my new me and I restarted my trip. Next slide. Being in army, I could not hide. There was no question of hiding the disease. And a lot of people, they say we were not able to tell our employer and all these things. In army, you are supposed to be in a shape one, which is medically fit. And that's why I was placed in the low medical category straight away because of my Parkinson and as per the army rules and regulation. So I knew that since when I was placed in low medical category, that'll be the end of my career as well as rank promotion is concerned. I was thrown out of mainstream. Because in army, you get promotions unless you are in category one. Low medical category, only war casualties are probably promoted. So I accepted it as a part of my destiny. So why worry and unnecessarily thinking? Because the human being has a great quality of imagination. We keep imagining things which are not going to happen. And we make our present horrible. So as know that life is always a compromise between your feeling and your reality. And I said with Parkinson, I have planned some future. I may not be able to attain that future, but I still have a future. Next slide, please. Next slide. Well, as you, everybody knows, it's a game of mind. Everything is between, as Martina Navratilova said, it is the game is played between 2 ears. That 6 inches field is the mind field, where if you are not able to have a control over your mind, you don't know what you want to achieve, you can't succeed, because life will keep throwing googlies at you. So I was carrying on as usual. Suddenly after a few months, one day my commandant called me and told me that there has been a letter from our army headquarters, since my paper has reached there, that in view of your Parkinson, you having a physical disability, so you cannot be performing surgery because it will be risk to patient. When my commander said, do you think? He said, no, I can't even make out you have a Parkinson. It is that you only came and told us that you got a Parkinson. You have been diagnosed with Parkinson. I said, they have a, unfortunately, people think that Parkinson, oh, he must be having shaking hands and dyskinesias and all sort of that mental picture is there, even among doctors also. So I said, there's no question of, I'm not going to take part. What has happened is I did it at a part of destiny, but this thing I am going to fight. I said, I am no way physically disabled. I have a full confidence in my professional competence, and I will continue to perform surgeries till I feel that if I will not do anything in interest of, which is not in interest of the patient. So I made it an issue because I had a full confidence in myself. Next slide. Well, I took it as a challenge. And my commandant told me, you know, fighting an organization is not so easy. I said, I am prepared to fight the war on two fronts, that is Parkinson and the organization. I had to prove to them that I am physically fit and I am professionally competent. Next slide. I said, I'll prove to them that I am physically fit. In he said, well, I presented, and he said, okay. No, since I had told that I am physically fit, I had to prove to them that I am second to none. So in army, every quarter of the year, there is a every soldier has to go to the BPT, PPT, which is battle proficiency efficiency test or peacetime to fitness. It is held, and luckily after 3 months, it was the annual BPT and PPT for them, in which you have to run about 3.2 kilometers in a stipulated time and do some tests like climbing and roping. And then upon that, you are graded excellent, good, fair, or poor. Next slide. See, since I had to prove to myself, I started practicing. You can't overnight go and run and you come in excellent. You have to practice hard, like all sportsmen, they do. I used to daily get up in the morning, sometimes 4 or 5 in the morning also, and used to go for a run. I used to regularly go to the gym because I had set a few targets for myself. And not even a single day I missed. And on the final day, when there was a station BPT, the army commander had come and all officers were lined up and they were all told to run. And to my surprise also, not only I came in excellent category, I was the first officer. I came first in among all the officers of the category of with age more than 45 years. And there was a big difference between first and the second person. And the evening, there was a social function in the institute where the army commander not only praised me, he bullshitted all the other officers. He said, you people from arms, infantry, armored, and artillery, and all those fighting arms, you people have been beaten by a doctor. And he gave me immediately commendation card for my physical capability. So, next slide. With that, my, as far as physical fitness was concerned, it silenced all the people, those who had a doubt about my physical. No, I had to prove to them that I am professionally competent. I was told that the team of surgeons will come who will see you operating, headed by a senior consultant surgery. There was nothing I had to do some extra because I was already operating and I was regularly operating. So prove to them that you are wrong, because most of the people have an impression that Parkinson has got a resting tremor like this. But when you do action, they disappear. So purposely I kept 5 cases in the OT. And the first case I kept was a stapedectomy. This is an operation, microsurgery of the year, where a very fine hand movement is required. So I showed it to them. And the second case I kept was an endoscopic removal of some foreign body denture from the esophagus. So after seeing the 2 cases, they were very fully satisfied. And then they told me, we don't want to further see your surgery. Next slide. And then as a result, for next 9 years of my service left, I was continued at senior advisor ENT, and I was later on even posted as a professor of ENT to FMC Pune. So, this is the photograph with the Director General of Health, DG FMS, Air Marshal Doshi, who gave me, was given an award also. Next slide. Next slide. Well, friends, go to the previous one. Previous one. Well, nothing can stop you. It is just you who is stopping yourself. If you have a belief in yourself and you have a fixed goal set for you and you are not shying of hard work, you can achieve whatever you want to achieve in life. Next slide. you got to have.
Next slide.
Next slide. Yeah. In the end, as I said, I was, this is my last month before I went for surgery for my cancer. I was playing golf in the Army Golf Club, Dholakua. This is January 2021. Well, we all develop courage, not only by always in a happy condition. It is only when you have, you face with difficult situation and challenging adversities, that is the time you get real courage in the life. Next slide. And life is very funny. It is even tougher than a teacher. The teacher teaches you and then take the exam. In life, you are subjected to exam first and then you learn the lesson. So one thing I was very sure that since I had no control what life does to me, I had no control that at the age of 49, I was diagnosed with a Parkinson disease. But then I decided I must control the way I want to deal with the Parkinson. I'm not going to give the remote of my life to Parkinson. I will keep it with me. And I change certain my daily activities of daily living and modified my life. And somehow I always feel that the management and the treatment of the Parkinson is not medicine. It is the, I put, this is my theory, I put the mental health as a number one line of treatment, then physical health, and then come the medicine. Your mental health is very important. Because unless you are mentally strong, you know what to do. You cannot control your Parkinson. So you got to have positivity in you. You got to get negative things coming to you. And don't see another patient with all those advanced disabilities. If you see them, you will start thinking and even you will get them. So what is very important is you, because Parkinson, every patient is a different patient. And whatever the other person has got, it is not you will get it. So stop thinking all these things. Remain with the, interact with other Parkinson patient because they are the best motivators. They can motivate each other. And don't do the negative thinking. Be positive. Try and keep your mind under control with the yoga or with the meditation. And then comes a physical health. Exercise.
Yeah. Dr. Kakkar, we will need to...
Okay, I'll just
finish. Yeah.
Because so the exercise is very important.
Correct.
And please mark it my word, there is no compromise on exercise. It is a part of your, make it a part of your routine. And then third come the medicines. Next slide, please. I'll just take 2 seconds. Next slide. Well, as you can all read it, there's a very nice quotation. Next slide. And thank you, as a written positive thinking is not only about expecting everything best to happen. It is all about whatever happened to you is the best. And since I'm short of time, so I wanted to tell you that recently I was diagnosed with a cancer prostate. I said whatever happened is for the past. Everybody said very sorry. I said no, this is the best thing has happened because the cancerous mass was already there in prostate. I was not aware of that. But when I went for a routine investigation and it got diagnosed and I've been able to surgically get it out of. Sorry, sir, I've taken more time.
No, it was an inspiring talk. And I think a lot of people who have been listening would have been inspired. And again, the common message is that let not disease overtake you or overwhelm you. You overwhelm the disease or you conquer the disease. We move on to a very inspirational talk now by a very, very well-known person called Dr. Rebecca Gilbert. Dr. Rebecca Gilbert is a vice president and a scientific advisor of American Parkinson's Disease Association. She has been working as a movement disorder specialist. She graduated from Weill Cornell University, and then she did a movement disorder fellowship from Columbia Presbyterian University. So basically, she is a neurologist, very well trained in the treatment of Parkinson's disease, but decided to give a significant part of her life or a time of her day to the service of Parkinson's disease patients by joining American Parkinson's Disease Association in 2018. She is now vice president and scientific advisor on their board. And today we have her talking to us. Unfortunately, she had to excuse herself for some commitment. So she has sent her presentation, which we would be sharing with you. Dr. Rebecca Gilbert's presentation, please.
Everyone, thank you so much for having me. My name is Rebecca Gilbert, and I am Chief Scientific Officer at American Parkinson's Disease Association. Today, I will be talking to you about winning over Parkinson's disease. And I'm going to focus on six things that you can control to feel some ownership over this journey that you have with Parkinson's disease. And of course, these are six things beyond seeing your doctor and taking your medications. Here are the six things that we'll be discussing today: sleep, diet, social support, information, exercise, and activities. Now, I want to be clear about the title that was given to me for this talk, Winning Over Parkinson's Disease. Certainly, these six things and various other things are available for you to feel ownership and take control over your Parkinson's disease. But if you feel like, you know what, even though I'm doing all these things right, Parkinson's is winning anyway, it isn't your fault. Parkinson's disease is a really difficult disorder. And what the last thing we want to do is blame people with Parkinson's disease for not feeling better. And that is not the goal of this talk at all. We know Parkinson's disease is extremely difficult. Every day can potentially be a struggle. And what these six things are ways for you to try to do your best in the face of those challenges. So on that note, I want to start to delve into these six items that can help you on your journey. We'll start with sleep. Why is sleep so important in Parkinson's disease? Well, everybody knows that if you don't get a good night's sleep, you're going to feel tired and you're going to feel sluggish. And that may cause you to take excessive naps during the day. And when you take excessive naps during the day, you may not be able to sleep at night. And you end up in this vicious cycle where your sleep is not regulated. When you feel tired during the day, your Parkinson's symptoms may be worse, your thinking even may be worse. And so I implore you to talk with your doctor about ways to improve your sleep. Now, there is no one-size-fits-all approach to sleep in Parkinson's. There are multiple sleep disorders that can interfere in your sleep. And in addition to multiple reasons why your sleep might not be ideal in Parkinson's, you may also have fatigue independent of not being able to sleep. And so your doctor may need to approach your sleepiness, your poor sleep, and your fatigue in different ways, depending on what your problem is. So it's important to really delve into that issue so that you can maximize your sleep at night and your wakefulness during the day to really get the most out of your days and improve those symptoms that are affected so deeply by sleep. Now we're going to turn to diet. Diet is an extremely important part of your life that you can control. And there are multiple diets out there that say that they are beneficial for Parkinson's disease. But what we have data on, what's been studied to help the brain, are these two diets, the Mediterranean diet and the MIND diet. So what is the Mediterranean diet? It is a diet you may be very familiar with. It's a diet that's rich in vegetables and fruits, whole grains, legumes such as beans, peas, and lentils, nuts, low-fat proteins such as fish and poultry, and a fat source that is made up of olive oil. The MIND diet is extremely similar to the Mediterranean diet, but it sort of fleshes out a little bit the different elements of the Mediterranean diet. So in terms of vegetables, what is most preferable are green leafy vegetables in the MIND diet. So spinach, kale, and that sort of thing. In terms of fruits, the most recommended fruit on the Mind Diet are berries, and particularly blueberries. In the Mind Diet, nuts are considered the best source of snacking, so you can snack on nuts during the day. And the last element of the Mind Diet that's slightly different than the Mediterranean diet is the use of wine, specifically red wine, on a daily basis, or a little bit of red wine every day. And this is, these are two diets were studied formally in people with Parkinson's disease. And this paper that I have in the bottom left came out recently and showed that if you take people with Parkinson's disease and ask them to tell you about their diets, people who adhered to Mind Diets and Mediterranean diets had later onset of their Parkinson's disease than people that did not. And so this potentially can be extrapolated to more generally, that these diets are very good for brain, the brain in general, and very good for people with Parkinson's. The third element we're going to talk about is support, is feeling that you're supported by your family, your community, by a spiritual guide that you may have. And in addition, you may find support from a community of like-minded Parkinson's people who have the same challenges you do and may offer tips and support and advice. And so that's something that can be sought out. In America, we have the American Parkinson's Disease Association and various other associations to help people find that support that they need in their communities and in their life. In where you may live, there may be a different organization that can help you with this type of effort, but finding that social support is so incredibly crucial for every human, and specifically for people with Parkinson's who need that extra bit of help to get them through the day. And part and parcel of this social support is support at work. Many of you may be working adults who need to have a little bit of extra help at work in order to keep working because of your Parkinson's issues. And the main two issues that kind of come to a head in Parkinson's disease and work are the issue of disclosure, so telling people that you have Parkinson's. And that may lead to a discussion about what kind of accommodations work can provide to keep you working. And I have multiple patients who had to navigate these challenges. On one hand, I had a 45-year-old patient who was a real estate contractor. And he navigated his Parkinson's disease by joining forces with a partner who did a lot of the writing, the actual physical writing during meetings, because he had a hard time doing that under pressure. And that worked out well. He disclosed, obviously, his condition to his partner, but did not disclose it to any of his clients. And with a lot of hard work and using his partner to best effect, he was able, or still is able, to continue working. On the other end, I had a 57-year-old woman with a very high-stress job. She disclosed at work, but found that even though she did disclose, she was had a very, very high stress situation. Normally, it was very hard for her to get there on time. She got home really late. She didn't have time to do the things she needed to do, like exercise and make sure she ate healthily. And so she decided at the age of 57 to take an early retirement. And then I had a patient right in the middle who didn't want to take an early retirement. And by disclosing to her work, she was able to get specific work accommodations, such as dictation software installed on her computer, and a special software that minimized her tremor when using the computer. And with those work accommodations and with a social support system at work that worked with her, she is able to continue working. And so the whole spectrum can be represented, and you need to find where you are on that spectrum to help you get through your challenges. The next thing to talk about is getting information, getting accurate information about your Parkinson's. There is so much out there on the web. Some is good, some is bad, and you want to find those reliable sources. I'd like to point you to my organization, apaparkinson.org. There are many other sources as well of good information, but our information will give you online resources, publications that can be downloaded, webinars that can be viewed. We have a hotline that can be accessed using the phone, 1-800-223-2732 for questions. And we also have a lot of online events that include educational programming, classes of all sorts, exercise classes, dance classes. We have classes in the visual arts as well. And I would urge you to check out our website, apdaparkinson.org/events, and you can access all that we have to offer. And I want to talk a little bit about exercise. I know that exercise is going to be the focus of many other talks in this series. And so I was asked not to focus on this, but you can't have a talk entitled Winning Against Parkinson's Disease without mentioning at least exercise as being part of this group of activities that you can do to improve your situation. So exercise can help manage symptoms, can help improve quality of life. We know that being sedentary and deconditioned can increase stiffness, can increase stooped posture, can contribute to poor endurance. The Center for Disease Control recommends 150 minutes of moderate intensity or 75 minutes of vigorous intensity exercise for all older adults. So that's a benchmark that you can use to see if you are reaching that goal. And when you're designing your exercise program, consider the four different types of exercise, and those include aerobic, strengthening, stretching, and balance. So trying to find some kind of combination of activities that take those four elements into account. And I want to point your attention to the SPARK study. And this is a study that was conducted by the National Institutes of Health in the United States, which really wanted to study the effects of exercise in a very robust way on many, many patients. Now, as you probably know, there's a tremendously large literature on exercise and Parkinson's. Most of those studies are small, maybe 10 to 20 patients. So this study really wanted to delve into exercise on a broader scale where more patients are involved. And this study looked at 128 patients with early Parkinson's, not on any medication. And they were enrolled either in high intensity treadmill exercise, moderate intensity treadmill exercise, or they were on the wait list and weren't doing either of these and were the control group. And after 6 months, the high intensity group had no change on their rating scale, but the control group that weren't exercising had a 3-point change. And that's pretty significant. And so it's sort of like the salmon swimming upstream. You think you may not be getting anywhere, but by not getting anywhere, that means you're really not going backwards. And that's really what we're after. We want people's Parkinson's to remain the same. We don't want it to get worse. Remaining the same is a huge goal and a huge, huge win. And so that's something that you want to keep in mind. And a phase 3 study of this type of a really in-depth look at exercise is underway now with 370 participants. So the data will be even more robust in support of, potentially support of exercise, high intensity exercise for people with Parkinson's disease. I also want to emphasize that it's not just getting your heart rate up or stretching or all those elements of exercise that are so important. There's another element that may be crucial in Parkinson's disease, and that is novelty, teaching the brain something new. And this could be teaching the brain how to move in a new way. This could be teaching the brain a new skill of some other type. It may be learning a new language. It may be learning a visual arts skill. It may be learning cooking, anything that gets the brain doing something that it does not know how to do already is so incredibly important throughout the lifetime of every human and especially people with Parkinson's disease. And this study that I have on this slide really helps to illustrate that. On the left, we have a picture of a running wheel, a rat running wheel, where some of the slats have been removed. And so as the rat ran on the wheel, they had to figure out where to put their feet. There was a cognitive skill involved in running on this wheel. On the other side, actually, I think I said right, we're talking about this one, this picture, the left picture where some of the slats were removed. On the other picture, we have a regular running wheel where the rat was able to exercise as quickly as they possibly could, but there was no cognitive input that needed to be taken into account. The brains of these rats were then looked at, and the amount of blood flow in the brains were assessed. In a rat that had pure aerobic activity, they just ran on that rat wheel as fast as they possibly could. Their brains actually looked a little worse than the rats who ran in a way where they had to involve skill. Now, the rats that had to involve skill were not running as fast. Their heart rate was not as high as the rats that ran on the aerobic wheel. And so, even without that additional aerobic element, their brains looked better. And that was because of that element of skill and novelty. And so that leads us to the possibility that when you are exercising, perhaps learn a new motor skill at the same time. Perhaps dance, a certain type of dance that you don't know. Tango has been studied in Parkinson's, for example. Other types of dance have been studied. Karate has been studied. Tai Chi. These may be motor movements that your body doesn't know yet. And adding that element of learning to the exercise can be so important. So on that level, it's not just movement that may need to have that novel approach as well, but all the other activities that your brain is craving to do. And these may involve hobbies of all kinds. And here's a little schematic of different hobbies that a person may undertake: photography, fishing, sewing, visual arts, knitting, cooking, etc. There's so many things that are new and exciting that a person can take on. And all this can help the brain with that additional element of novelty. Now, music is a hobby that many people may have, and music may involve singing, it may involve moving to music like dance, it may involve just listening to music. But music has incredible power over us, and so it unlocks lots of different parts of the brain that may be really, really important in Parkinson's. It can give our movements rhythm. It can give our movements more purpose just from listening and moving to music. And it may help our souls just with the beauty of it per se. And so music is something that we all crave and can be very helpful to people with Parkinson's disease as well. There are music therapies that have been developed that help people in their movement by music, moving to music. Visual arts, in a similar way, can be very, very helpful to people with Parkinson's disease. There are many, many reports of people who develop Parkinson's disease and then unlock through their Parkinson's disease a skill or a talent for painting or for art that they did not know they had before. And so that is a theme that we sometimes hear. And there are classes for people with Parkinson's disease to take on these visual arts. And those are really, really exceptional classes that you may be interested in. And finally, dance, which of course is incorporated into a music, into moving to music. And I want to point out that on our website, apdaparkinson.org, we have a virtual calendar, which you can access with just a very simple addition to apdaparkinson.org/events. And you can find access to singing classes, visual arts classes, dance classes. And so please join us and take advantage of that if you can. And finally, I want to put everything in context. And so we talked about a lot of different elements of things that you can control, and those included sleep, those included information gathering, hobbies. We talked specifically about music. We talked about social support. We talked about diet. And all these things fit into the rubric of how you and your healthcare team can help you in the most effective way. And so along with all the elements that you can control, we have the diagnosis and medical management, the piece that comes from your movement disorder specialist or your neurologist, your general health care team that may include your primary care physician and various other subspecialties. We have psychosocial support, so more professional support of your mental health, which can help along with the support team that you're going to embrace yourself with, including any support groups that you go to. We have exercise and wellness professionals, and we talked a lot about that, how to get that element into your life, the importance of exercise, getting the heart rate up, strengthening, stretching, balance, but also novelty in your movements as well. And finally, rehabilitation specialists that can help pull all these together to maximize your quality of life. On that note, I want to thank you so much for listening today. I want to again point out the organization I'm from, American Parkinson Disease Association. We'd love to help you in any way that we can. Thanks again for listening. And I hope that with this information, you can feel like you are winning against your Parkinson's disease. Thank you so much.
That was a very inspiring presentation from Dr. Rebecca Gilbert. Can I have my video permitted? Yeah, thank you. So my video seems to be disabled by the host. Yes, thank you. Again, to sum it up, we have answered most of the questions that were on the chat, and all the comments have been noted also. Basically, as I said, our presenters, Dr. Kakkar, Dr. Hari Prasad, Dr. Shantipriya, and Sandesh, all of them gave the same message in a different way, in their own way, what Rebecca Gilbert gave scientifically or as a medical consultant. If you look at them, what was common amongst all four of them? All four of them have developed skills outside their level of comfort zone. Dr. Kakkar is a surgeon, but he is engaged into various other activities. Mr. Hari Prasad has been an MBA. He has been engaged with many other activities. Same with Dr. Shantipriya, who has shown multifaceted personality, and Mr. Sandesh Godbole, who engaged himself into music. So I think the message that we should take from here on is that three things are important: not losing our hope against life once you get Parkinson's disease. Second, to get motivated and continue to do regular exercise and engage ourselves physically and mentally, and try to develop and learn new skills. I would like to introduce you to a couple of people whom your names you had been seeing. One is Ms. Anulipal Nandi. She is a coordinator of the Parkinson Care Trust, and you have been communicating with her on WhatsApp and other chats and through emails. Ms. Bharti Karkera also has been very much instrumental in helping us organize this program, and she works with the patients of Parkinson's disease, so we have got information directly right from the place where it matters most. And we have Chogle Medical Consult, the digital and audiovisual team and partners who have been helping us conduct this program. Lot of people have asked as to how can they get the presentation. I would like to share this once again, this slide, so that you can take a snapshot of that and decide. So you have this name, tiny URL. Please note down this name and try to enroll yourself here, and you should be able to get the access to all the presentations later on also in a recorded format in case you have missed anything. With that, let me just finally check out if there are any questions. Yes, muscular dystonia patient can take COVID vaccines, and acupressure is helpful. Yes, it may be helpful in select cases. You can try it out. With that, I would like to thank everyone here present today and who has joined us for this webinar, and invite them all again to meet us on the 3rd of April for the last webinar, which is going to be a most useful webinar because it's going to be talking about medical and surgical management of Parkinson's disease. Thank you. Good night.